Discovering Alabama is a production of the Alabama Museum of Natural History.
It's a little south of Casablanca and a little north of Calcutta, about the same latitude as Cairo or Shanghai. It's a place you might not expect to find in Alabama. But like those distant cities, it has hosted voyagers from across the globe. Barely 15 miles long, not more than 2 miles wide, its exotic environment sustains a remarkable variety of ecosystems. This small spit of land is fragile enough to be moved by wind and wave, yet strong enough to have weathered hundreds of years of hurricanes. It's Alabama's Land's End, Dauphin Island. One of a string of barrier islands that runs along the Gulf Coast, Dauphin Island separates and protects the mainland from the open ocean. Lying at the mouth of Mobile Bay, downstream of one of the largest watersheds on the continent, the island is one of few broadly diverse and relatively stable barrier islands in North America. It's unusual for a barrier island because it hosts nearly all the ecosystems and wildlife found along the Gulf Coast. Hi, I'm Doug Phillips. Hundreds of years ago, the first explorers to Dauphin Island stood on this spot. Join me for a modern-day exploration of Alabama's unique island realm. This program is about a land unknown to many people, a land that in many ways has escaped the hustle and bustle of modern civilization, a place with bountiful backcountry, forests, streams, and wildlife more diverse than can be found in much of the inhabited world. Come along with me as we explore the natural wonders of this land. Come along as we discover Alabama. Geologically, Dauphin Island is classified as a barrier island, one that acts as a wall of sorts between the ocean and the continental coastline. And like most barrier islands, it's low and sandy. No point on the island reaches much above sea level. Welcome to Discovering Alabama. Barrier islands are both dynamic and mobile. Not only does the action of wind and water constantly change the shape of a barrier island, but the island itself actually moves. On the northern Gulf Coast, currents generally carry sediments from east to west. And if you've ever stood at water's edge down here, you've probably felt the persistent westward tug. But Dauphin Island also catches much of the sand and the soil that washes down from the north, carried to Mobile Bay by the great rivers of Alabama, and steered to the island by wind and wave. Over the last 100 years, the island has moved westward, adding about 4 miles to its length. But where nature adds, she also takes away. Erosion is a fact of life for barrier islands. Though we've made some attempt to stabilize parts of Dauphin Island, the shoreline erodes on average about 12 feet per year. And where we've worked the hardest to keep things in place, on the developed eastern end, it seems we lose the most, in places 30 feet per year. Typically, the many forces of geological change want barrier islands to move little bit by little bit. But sometimes Mother Nature has other plans. In 1979, one of the worst storms in memory unleashed its fury on the Alabama coast, Hurricane Frederick. 140-mile-an-hour winds drove a storm surge across Dauphin Island, blowing completely through the western end. 3/4 of the island was flooded. The overall elevation was lowered, in some cases as much as 5 feet. Not one of the island structures was left untouched by the storm. Mother Nature may be harsh, but she's also forgiving. And the beauty and natural wealth of Dauphin Island have always lured people to her shores. For thousands of years, Native Americans made frequent visits here. They feasted on the fish and oysters from the Mississippi Sound and left huge mounds of shells along the North Shore. In the 16th century, the Spanish charted the Gulf Coast. Their colony at Pensacola failed, but their maps of the area were passed on to the French. On Saturday, January 31st, 1699, between noon and 2 o'clock, a French-Canadian soldier named Pierre Iberville anchored off what he recorded as Massacre Island, named for the piles of human bones he found when he went ashore. The island kept the name until 1711, when Iberville's brother, Bienville, changed it to Isle Dauphine, after the fair wife of the Duke of Burgundy. Dauphin Island spent its next 100 years involved in wars between Spain, France, and England. But the United States claimed the land in the Louisiana Purchase in 1803. A few years later, the young country built a fort to defend the passage into Mobile Bay, Fort Gaines. It became famous during the Civil War Battle of Mobile Bay. 2,000 federal troops stormed the fort from the west, while Admiral Farragut shelled it from the east. And after 3 long days of battle, the hardy Confederates surrendered. On August 8, 1864, the Stars and Stripes was hoisted over the fort, and Fort Gaines never saw another battle. Though it was later active in World War I and World War II, its greatest moment in history had passed. As we move across the island from the beach on the southern shore to the salt marsh on the northern, we encounter a variety of ecosystems, all interconnected with one another, all driven by nature's vital sources of energy, sunlight, wind, tides, and rain. Wind and wave beat an ever-constant rhythm against the sands of the lower beach, making it too harsh an environment for most plants to grow. But a few feet up from the water's edge, where the environment is not as harsh, several kinds of hardy plants begin to take root: pennywort, camphor, and beach morning glory. As we move further away from the surf and onto the first line of dunes, the plants are protected from the salt spray and grow thicker and taller. The tall, lacy tops of the sea oats capture wind-blown sand, which sifts downward and over time builds up the dune. Behind the first line of dunes is the inner dune region. Broom grass and Bermuda grass grow here, and it's the home of a shy little critter known as the beach mouse. Now an endangered species, the beach mouse is one of the few mammals that makes its home close to the ocean's edge, burrowing beneath small clumps of grass. Beyond the inner dune region lies the highest and one of the most impressive geographic features on the island, the high dunes. Protected from the constant assault of wave and tide, the high dunes reach up to 45 feet or more. At a distance from the salty ocean water, the high dunes are home to an increasing variety of plants, even some small trees like scrub oak and sassafras. This vegetation holds the high dune in place and captures the wind-blown sand that makes it grow. A dune this large may have grown for several hundred years.
The dunes themselves are the protective device for the barrier islands. They have probably the most interesting type of mechanism, because when the storm attacks the dune, the dunes piled up at a certain height, and gravity, with the attack of the water, when the water rolls back, the sand just rolls down the hill. It's that simple. But it reaches an equilibrium point and builds up a bar offshore underwater. That bar then becomes a protective device in itself, further offshore than the sand was originally. Then after the storm period is over, that sand is gradually transported back up onto the beach. And at high tide, it gets stranded there. When it dries out, the wind blows around. And as the wind blows the sand, the bits of vegetation that were seeded, but they're really cuttings, they're not seeds, begin to grow up through the sand, and they trap that windblown sand and gradually put the sand back up at the top of the hill where the whole process can start over again.
Perhaps one of the more intriguing ecological features of Dauphin Island is its forest. Pines, hardwoods, freshwater lakes, and swamps. This is a very different world from the sand and the sea oats of the usual barrier island. This forest exists for several reasons, not the least of which lies a few hundred yards out at sea. Known both as Sand Island and Pelican Island, these two small islands are part of the same narrow piece of land that serves as a first line of defense, sheltering the eastern end of the island from waves, wind, and hurricane. They are barrier islands for a barrier island. A second line of defense is the high dune, which keeps all but the worst storms from flooding the forest with salt water. In turn, the trees buttress the dunes, keeping them from being blown further inland. And within this protection, a remarkably lush natural setting has flourished. But long before humans came to the island, it was a haven for distant migrants. Dauphin Island lies in the middle of the Mississippi Flyway, one of the larger, more heavily used flyways on the continent. And it's the first stop after a 500-mile journey across the Gulf from the Yucatan Peninsula. More than 300 species of migrating birds, some from as far away as Cape Horn at the southern tip of South America, stop over on Dauphin Island. In addition to the migrants, most of the species that are native to Alabama make their home here. The Audubon Sanctuary is here on the eastern end of the island. But the overall bird diversity has prompted efforts to set aside the entire island as a preserve. The wealth of plant and animal life on Dauphin Island depend on the variety of habitats, of ecosystems. And I'm standing right in the middle of one, the salt marsh. Salt marshes form wherever flatland is regularly flooded and drained. They provide habitat for many kinds of plants and animals, including shrimp. The marshes filter nutrients and toxins and help control erosion. Nearly all of the marshland in Alabama is freshwater, but here tidal ebb and flow create pockets of salt marsh that stretch across much of the northern side of the island. Marsh plants, the marsh itself, would have a tougher time surviving on the ocean side. The plants aren't strong enough to take the pounding of the waves, and they can't live in the very salty water of the Gulf. In fact, if you look close at the grasses in a salt marsh, you can tell something about the salinity of the water. As you get closer to shore, where freshwater springs and drainage from the island make the water less salty, smooth cord grass gives way to taller, denser needle rush. The line between these grasses is fairly clear and marks a difference in water salinity. Wherever a river or a stream drains into a body of water connected to the sea, and seawater is diluted by freshwater, an estuary forms. The estuary here stretches west from Mobile Bay into the Mississippi Sound, and south from the Mobile-Tensaw Delta to Dauphin Island. Even though they may spend much of their lives in the open Gulf, many kinds of fish and shellfish require estuaries to grow and develop. In fact, the estuary is the base for much of the wildlife found both on land and in the waters around Dauphin Island. Shrimp, for example, hatch at sea, but are carried back to the estuary by tides and currents, where they find food and shelter from predators. The upper reaches of tidal creeks that wind through salt marshes are particularly favored by small fish. Like shrimp, they grow in the estuary and migrate back into the open sea, where they repeat the spawning process.
We're here at the mouth of Mobile Bay aboard the research vessel, the A.E. Verrill, that belongs to the Dauphin Island Sea Lab. Today we're out here on the bay on a mission in which we're going to take this trawl, it's called an otter trawl, and we're going to lower the trawl through the water column. And the trawl will eventually end up on the bottom of Mobile Bay, and we'll drag that trawl about 20 minutes. What's interesting in an operation like this is that we'll get organisms from the top of the water column all the way to the bottom. The estuary itself, because it has low salinity, is a natural nursery ground. Many organisms reproduce in this estuary and raise their young here, because estuaries worldwide have an abundance of food and low salinity. Many organisms within the estuary have a rapid growth rate. Some reach sexual maturity in less than 1 year's time. So to do that, they need a lot of food. This rich resource is here and is an abundant. One of the things that you'll see when we start to bring the trawl up is that you'll see that the size of the organisms are small, predominantly because they are juveniles. It's a young fisheries in this area here. As they mature, they move offshore, become part of the Gulf of Mexico fisheries. One of the interesting aspects of this catch is that we have some representatives of the group Chondrichthyes, the sharks and the rays. This is the Atlantic sharp-nosed shark. They get a little larger than that. This one here and this one here is also a sharp nose. One of the things you'll notice is that this one here had a hook in his mouth, so at one time he was caught. We'll remove that and we'll turn this guy loose. We'll just send them back over the side, and they'll survive very nicely along with this one right here. Now here, these two specimens here are bonnethead sharks. Notice they're quite a bit distinctive difference in their crown here, in their head. Their eyes are out on their side there. And other than that, they have the same distinctive patterns of the shark, of all the species of these Chondrichthyes. We'll turn him loose. One of these we're going to keep, because I'm not exactly sure what genus and species this one is with these spots all down him. So I'm going to keep this one and bring him back to the lab so that we can identify him. That's one of the missions of our laboratory, is to take a look at different and unique animals of our estuary. The other member of the Chondrichthyes, you'll note, is the southern stingray. Now normally, the stingray only has one single barb, but this one has produced two barbs, one there and one there. Both these barbs are long and serrated, and they actually have a bacteria associated with the barb. You'll note that he's camouflaged. There's the bottom of the animal. There's the top of the animal. So he's very well camouflaged to the habitat. He lives right on the bottom. And we're going to turn him loose, and he'll go back to the bottom and survive. Mobile Bay estuarine supports another organism known as the bay squid. Scientific name is Lolago. The bay squid doesn't get much larger than you see right here. The one here is an adult. You'll notice that his color is constantly changing. And what causes that color change are little cells known as chromatophores. The blinking that you see right now, the blinking on and off, are those chromatophores being constricted and released.
The coastal waters of Alabama are blessed with a great variety of life. Much of it has supported us for thousands of years. But today, the bounty of these waters, under increasing pressure from development, may depend on how much we know about the fragile habitats that nurture them.
For many years, Alabama's coastal environments were not well understood. But with the research undertaken by the Dauphin Island Sea Lab and the Marine Environmental Research Consortium, our knowledge has expanded considerably.
The Sea Lab is possibly unique in the state because it was originally designed and intended as an educational facility for the member schools of the consortium, and that in itself is valuable. But to have good education, and particularly at the college level and at the graduate level, we had to have good faculty, and those people are interested in research. So what is involved at the lab is an almost unique blend of research activities that are translated into information for the general public, for the management community, and finally into the classes themselves. And our classes may be kindergarten kids or they may be PhD candidates. But either way, the same people are doing it, and it is an opportunity for us to try to explain to people how the bay and the coastal area functions, and the way we try to understand it is so that it can be better managed.
The Sea Lab research not only gives the nation a better understanding of the marine environment, it's also important to area residents as well. With so many businesses dependent on the sea for their livelihood, the research takes on new meaning as the island continues to be commercially developed. If the early explorers could somehow return to Dauphin Island today, they'd find some things very much the same, and other things very much changed. Ironically, the qualities that attract people to the island, the natural beauty, the pristine waters, and the abundant sea life, are the very things that are threatened by our presence. Since the mid-1950s, hotels and condominiums, even a country club, have intruded on the island landscape. Increasing evidence of the potential for commercial development that could crowd and strain the island environment.
Many of the residential lots on the shoreline, the waterfront lots, are built on wetlands or on very fragile beach systems. On the beach systems, there's been little compensation to protect the environment or to protect those private property investments. In the wetlands, in order to protect the property, they've bulkheaded and filled them, so they've actually taken the wetlands out of the system. For transportation, such as the airport that we have on the island, that is also bulkheaded and filled, and we probably lost over 100 acres of wetlands there. Not only have we lost the wetlands, but we've lost the tidal flow through those wetlands. These were areas that once supported large populations of Gulf diamondback terrapins, which are endangered species in the Gulf of Mexico. We cannot find them at the airport anymore because the whole system has been altered. Now that there are pressures on fishing that exceed the capacity for fish stocks to be maintained in many cases, these critical habitats that we've lost now become even more important, and you have to question whether 30 years ago the right decisions were made.
It's the nature of man to want the things that he builds to be permanent. It's the nature of nature to evolve and change. Perhaps this conflict is no more clearly evident than in the fragile environment of a barrier island.
What's really important is that we understand what Mother Nature's role is in changing barrier islands, so we can then appreciate what happens when man creates something on the island that's going to alter it. And we often find ourselves in conflict. Mother Nature wants one thing and man wants another. And whether that's opening or closing passes or having sand on the beach, we can spend an awful lot of money accomplishing what we want to do, only to have Mother Nature come back and say, well, I'd really rather have it the other way, and then she has it her way.
In Native American lore, islands were portrayed as the humps on the back of a great slowly moving sea snake. And early explorers to Dauphin Island reported that it had hourglass sands because they shifted so easily from one minute to the next. And in the case of barrier islands, we must remember that the forces of change in nature are actually the manifestations of a constant. Nature is constantly changing, endlessly creating and undoing, taking and returning. Like the migratory birds who stop over here to rest, we too are temporary visitors to the island, to this place where the processes, the forces of change in nature, will rule despite any expectations we might have to the contrary. So perhaps the wisest perspective is to try our best to live in harmony with the natural processes of the island. And maybe, with enough wisdom, this special hideaway can remain an island paradise for visitors yet to pass this way.
This program is supported by grants from the Alabama Forest Resources Center, promoting education and cooperation for all the benefits of proper forest management, the Alabama Department of Conservation and Natural Resources, State Lands Division, the Alabama Wildlife Federation, working for wildlife since 1935, and Legacy, partners in environmental education.